What does the Lord share with us from the North District, so she'll be delivering her message next week.
That seems appropriate.
Changes going on. Maybe we can play changes, but no. And then for our youth, well, Janice is not here today. She's hoping that you all can meet after church next Sunday. It is time already to pick dates and locations for the Sierra Service Project. And I know that it's been so meaningful for so many of you, so make sure to be here next Sunday. And now I invite you all to stand and greet one another as we pass the peace. Director who is Jewish shared with those who follow a prayer So the nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Rather, may all the inhabitants of the earth recognize and deeply know this great truth, that we have not come into this world for strife and division, nor for hatred and rage, nor provocation and bloodshed. We have come here only to encounter you, eternally blessed one. And so we ask your compassion upon us. Raise up by us what is written. I shall place peace upon the earth, and you shall lie down safe and undisturbed. And I shall banish evil beasts from the earth, and the sword shall not pass through your land. But let justice come in waves like water, and righteousness flow like a river. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of holiness, as the waters cover the sea. So may it be. And we say, Amen. Now, with the confidence of God's children, let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals, it is impossible,
There is no one who has left house, brothers or sisters, or mother or father, or children or fields, for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive a hundredfold now in this age, house of brothers and sisters, mothers and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. With the hearing of God's word, we are blessed.
May the Spirit help us to hear what God has to say.
I invite Andrew to come and share with us his message.
Hey, everyone. Thank you for being here. And I'm glad that, you know, people like me and people from the congregation have a chance to be up here. And I hope it's something that we continue to some extent, even if we have new leadership. It's very nice to hear from you all. So I wanted to share my thoughts, you know, on this scripture and the question that it brings to mind, the question that's been on my mind a lot, what is a Christian life? And you could rephrase that as, you know, what is a good Christian life, or what is a good life? The word good could be loaded. Jesus just reminded us of that in the scripture. But this passage, this story from Jesus' travels appears in all three of what we call the Synoptic Gospels, Mark, Matthew, and Luke. And we just heard Mark's version of the story. In that version, we saw someone comes to Jesus and asks what he must do to inherit eternal life. So what do we know about the person who approaches Jesus? The man has at least some possessions, many possessions, I think it says in the reading. Luke's gospel also says that this person is a ruler. And so the other two don't say that, at least in the translations, but it suggests that this person also has, you know, not just wealth, but some status and power. And another thing that this man has is the sense that maybe, you know, we're kind of inferring from his words, he has this nagging sense that simply following the commandments that he was taught, you know, the Ten Commandments of Moses, is not quite enough. But there is more to living a holy life, or as the man might say, a good life. And so when I think of this, one analogy that comes to mind is of students in a classroom. I spent a lot of time in school. I'm married to someone who teaches, and the academic classes get very much of it. And so I think of a student who's taking a class, and they have like a comfortable A, or maybe at least A minus in the class. And so, you know, people would look at that and say, you should feel pretty good about where you are. But the final exam is coming. And they want to be absolutely sure that they finish with the best grade possible. And so they come up to the teacher, and many, the teachers who are here, maybe there are a few, and most of you who are in school probably know this type of student. I know this student. I have maybe been this type of student. So that student approaches more specifics about what is on the exam, or an opportunity for extra credit just to, you know, be sure of their place, you know, at the head of the class. And that would be a little annoying to most teachers. I mean, you should be fine. Like, why are you bothering with Jesus? Jesus and can get, you know, kind of used to, like, oh, this is how Jesus speaks. But we should be a little shocked by that. That would be a big deal for any of us today, I think, to sell all you own and then give it to the poor and then come follow me, whatever that means for us. So where does that leave us? And so I said that this question of what it means to live a Christian life is a follower of Jesus that's been on my mind a lot lately. Let me tell you why. There have been a few people in my life, probably in yours too, who just seem to possess this natural goodness, this inner light of love, who these very other-centered lives, and they're just giving and giving. Their entire existence seems to be devoted to calling to help others around. And one such person who I know was born into an Irish Catholic family in Philadelphia. She was one of 10 siblings. You heard that right, 10. But she had a kind of independent streak. So while most of her siblings, they grew up, they stayed close to home, they got married, they had kids, she settled in the big city, in that part of the country, New York City, in a small studio apartment that she would call home for 42 years. She had a talent for language. She worked in educational publishing, editing books for her children. But living alone in the city could be daunting for anyone. And she faced depression and mental health challenges at a time when our society's vocabulary and understanding of these issues is not as well developed as today. And so she had to go seek treatment for that. But out of this lonely place that followed, she made a lifelong friend in the process of her treatment. She adopted 2 cats to keep her company at home. And she interviewed for a part-time job as a nanny to a 3-year-old boy whose parents both had demanding jobs with long hours. The 3-year-old is a boy. She became my nanny, and then my godmother and my dear friend. And then after that, she as I grew up, she started law school. She wasn't, she decided to go in the middle of life to start law school, and then she became an attorney for New York City's Child Services Agency. And she would argue in court for custodial arrangements that protected children's safety and well-being. She had hundreds of these cases at the time. It was a stressful job. And still in her meager spare time, she volunteered and overnight shifts at her church's homeless shelter. And she bravely faced a struggle with cancer for a few years until she passed on the next life in April of this year. And I'm 99% certain the only reason I'm in this church right now, or in any church really, is because I was a witness to her deep faith and love and how she put it into practice. And so I knew, I'm not talking about faith in this time of my life. I knew I had to talk about her today. I'm obviously thinking about her a lot. There's still grief there about her loss. But I'm incredibly grateful to her for the gift of her life and her faith. And I'm also a bit overwhelmed. So what a high bar. I feel like the NSC is Jesus. I'm wealthy, but I definitely have possessions, and it definitely some privilege, a lot of privilege, I'd say. So I feel like, I would be told, you're doing okay, but these are Christian lives, These are the people, who are being Christian. So, I was used to being an A student in school. I don't know if I can make an A in this class. So where does that leave me in the rest of us? Jesus likes to poke at established hierarchies of wealth and power. So you can see this at the reading that we had as part of that tradition. And every follower of Jesus be first or last in the work. And they be ahead of the last. Because there are 2.4 billion people in the world today who identify as Christian followers of Jesus. That's one-third of the world's population. And if 2.4 billion people were moving nomads who sold their possessions and left their families and living on the land and ultimately the generosity of others, the world would be a little chaotic. I don't know that would benefit me. And so, you know, even in the early Christian communities, they had families, they had community. They weren't, they weren't only living with the disciples. We need families, whether by birth or families we have found. And most of us do need a few possessions, at least, to feel not just secure, but to, you know, live and to work. And to be able to function day to day. And most of us need a steady place to lay our head at the end of the day. There's some debate among scholars and theologians about whether Jesus actually says the man needs to sell his possessions to inherit eternal life. Is it necessary, or is it just the extra credit, as it were? So in the three Gospels, the Gospel of Mark and Luke say that Jesus says to the man, there is one thing you lack. Matthew actually rephrased it as, if you wish to be perfect, in the English translation. So there's room for debate. And you could say, well, if you have lived an imperfect life, and you lack one thing, is that not still a virtuous life? If you're caring for your own family and friends, doing good in your community rather than roaming the world penniless, are you not doing the work of Christ? Most Christian thinkers would probably say some version of yes. But I think there's no question that Jesus needs to challenge us. Jesus looked at the rich man and he loved him. We just heard that. So that's what Jesus challenged him. It was a big challenge, but you know, so what end? So really take stock of what he had and what he most valued. His values and his possessions. Maybe he has possessions, but what are your values? And then calling on him to make an act of love. And the kind of act of love that Jesus tells him the man was not ready for, at least not yet. And some preachers have noted that the scripture passage does not say how the rich man's story ends. We just know what happened. Sad, but we don't know, this story doesn't end there. And we neither desire us. We feel overwhelmed. We all have times when the challenges come to us through emotional distress, through grief, through physical or economic hardship. Where the most necessary Christian act we can make is self-centered, that we just need to love ourselves and let God love us, to let the and to seek out comfort and restoration. But Jesus is also to remind us that love itself is not all warm and fuzzy feelings. Loving God and loving your neighbor is a challenge. Loving yourself can be a challenge. Maybe we are meant to turn away sad or shocked or overwhelmed or fearful by the challenge that we are presented with. But that's not the end of the story. Jesus doesn't walk away from us.
Your love and way to others. In the name of Jesus, we pray.